you have your Bible, could you please open it to Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. We're doing sermons this summer, just looking at Paul's letters, just kind of doing one sermon per letter, giving you the essence of what Paul is trying to get at in each of his letters. This week we're looking at Colossians, and this might be one of those sermons that elicits the response, I wonder what got into Pete. I'll just tell you up front what got into Pete. Jesus. Amen. I'm not sure, actually, who this sermon is for. I mean, I'm your shepherd, and this is the body of Bent Tree. It's obviously for us as a church. But I'm sensing all week long that it is also for ears outside these walls as well. I'm aware that my sermons now each week circle the globe through Telling the Truth radio ministry and through YouTube and podcasts and stuff, and as I was preparing this, I just sensed that the Lord had a message for the church as a whole and not just for our church, so we'll let the Holy Spirit sort all that out. I've told you before that there was a time when I was sitting at a stoplight, and as I sat there at the stoplight, a guy came perpendicular to me and turned the corner so fast that he almost flipped. His wheels almost came off the ground. He was just flying. I thought, that's crazy. That guy should get pulled over. And I didn't really know what to do, but I looked through my side rearview mirror and I saw a police car pull up next to the car that was right next to me. And so I'm going to go back up and tell that cop to go get that guy. So I shifted into reverse and I pushed on the accelerator. And it would have been a great idea, except a young woman had come and was sitting right behind me. And so I just, boom! And so the police car lights did go on, but wasn't for the crazy driver, it was for me. I was just trying to help. And the problem was I got distracted, and so I went backwards and I crashed. That's what happens when we get distracted. We back up until we crash. I also mentioned to you the time that I walked into the ladies' room at the Nashville airport because I was focusing on my texts on my phone, and I had no intention that morning of going to a ladies' room. I've never wanted to go into a ladies' room. There are a few places on the planet I would rather not be than a ladies' room, but I ended up there because I was distracted. When we get distracted, we end up in places we never intended to be. When we get distracted, we back up until we crash. The church in Colossae was distracted. The Apostle Paul heard news of their distraction and wrote a simple letter to get them focused in the right place again. I think the evangelical church in our contemporary day has gotten distracted in three fundamental ways. The first is that we've neglected expositional preaching. Expositional preaching is nothing more than simply teaching the Bible, pericope by pericope. A pericope is a whole section. It might be a paragraph or two paragraphs, but it's one thought section. And you teach the whole thought section, and you teach what the author intended for us to hear. That's expositional preaching. We've neglected it. The reason we've neglected it is because we got this idea that seekers don't want to hear the Bible, and we want to reach out to seekers. I have a firm conviction that seekers want to hear the Bible. Someone who is truly seeking God doesn't care what the preacher has to say. What they want to know is what the Bible has to say. So we got to preach for the seekers. I'm also firmly convinced that believers desperately need the Bible if they're going to grow in their faith too. So as a church, we've got to preach expositionally, but that's not what I want to talk to you about today. The second thing I'm really concerned about is I'm concerned that we've forgotten the rest of the world, that the Western church, resourced unlike any other church in history, has forgotten our less resourced brothers around the globe. Hoarding resources, we've neglected our third world siblings, we've effectively decelerated the spread of the gospel because of our myopic self-indulgence. But that's not what I want to talk to you about either. The third one is what I want to talk to you about. The third one overshadows the other two. And that is that I'm concerned in the evangelical church that we have supplanted Christ. We have replaced Jesus with scores of other things. And the church is struggling greatly as a result. You can attend a church service anywhere in our nation on a given Sunday and never hear Christ mentioned once in a church. That's like going to Ruth Chris and hoping for a big, huge, juicy filet and they bring you a Happy Meal instead. Or if Jesus is mentioned, he's mentioned in passing as the forgiver of your sins, which of course he is. But that's like reading page one of War and Peace and thinking you've got the whole story. It's certainly part of it, but it's just the beginning of it. Jesus is so much more than that. You say, Pete, why are you telling us this? We preach Christ here at Bent Tree. We teach Christ. We're always focused on Christ. And that is true to a degree, but that's something like saying we're one of the healthier horses at the glue factory. This is a systemic issue. This is a fundamental issue. It's deeply troubling. The evil one will do anything to distract you. The evil one will do anything to distract us. The evil one will do anything to distract the church from Christ. Anything. And he's been pretty successful. False teachers had infiltrated the church in Colossae, and they had distracted the church. They'd come in saying something along these lines. Yeah, Jesus is fine, but... Let me just tell you, any sentence that starts with Jesus is fine, but... Don't listen to the rest of the sentence. Jesus is fine, but... Look at Colossians chapter 2, verse 8. The Apostle Paul doesn't lay out what the false teachers were teaching in his letter, but he hints at it here and there, and in verse 8, he gives us our best hint at what they were teaching. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles of this world rather than on Christ. See to it that no one takes you captive. Circle takes you captive. The word means kidnapped through deceit. The imagery is of a slimy guy on a playground offering a small child candy. That's the image. Don't take the candy, Paul is saying. Don't be kidnapped. Don't be taken captive. Don't be tricked. Here's what they're going to say to you, Paul says. Yeah, Jesus is fine, but you need to add a little philosophy to Jesus. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy. Philosophy, in essence, is the love of wisdom. Paul wasn't degrading philosophy as an academic interest. He was speaking to religious philosophy, coming up with religious thinking systems that replace Christ. In Colossae, it was a strange mixture of dualism and angel worship and a very early form of Gnosticism, and it was all mixed up. And Paul doesn't even describe it for us because at the end of the day, it doesn't really matter what the religious philosophy was. Every age has seen different religious philosophies infiltrating the church, and we have our own new ones now. Denominationalism is one. Radical activism. It's another one that's creeping into the church. Name it, claim itism, nationalism. The philosophy is any system of thinking that reduces the role of Christ in our lives and in the church. Paul says, they'll also say, yeah, Jesus is fine, but you need to add some traditions. Jesus plus traditions. He says, see to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition. Underline the word tradition. In Colossae, the traditions they were struggling with were tied to the Jewish law. That's why in chapter 3, verse 11, Paul says, in the church there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, because they were being led astray to think that, yes, you can say yes to Jesus, but then you got to get in line with all these Jewish laws as well. Today, we're not that focused on the Jewish laws, but the church has come up with our own Christian laws, haven't we? Well, that's just the way we've always done it. You can hear an entire sermon series nowadays on why hymns from the pre-1800s are better than choruses from the 1970s, or vice versa. Don't miss my sermon next week. Drums are from Satan. Mixed bathing is too. Right? We'll spend a lot of time focusing on those types of things. In fact, many churches, you can preach drivel, but don't you dare mess with the wooden heavy pulpit that's there, because that's the sacred desk. Doesn't matter what you preach from it, but don't try to replace it with one of those fancy see-through things. So many sacred cows in the church, adult Bible fellowships, baptismal forms, liturgy, ordination, confession, Sunday school, perfect attendance pins, walk in the aisle, voting people into membership, reciting the Apostles' Creed and the Lord's Prayer every Sunday. And if you go to a church and you're visiting and they're reciting the Lord's Prayer, make sure you know if it's trespasses or debts, because if you say it wrong, everyone will look at you and you'll feel really stupid. All these traditions can be layered and layered and layered on top of Jesus, and he is inconsequential. He's unrecognizable as a result. Yeah, Jesus is fine, but you need to add some principles to help people grow, Paul would say next. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depends on human tradition and the basic principles, underline basic principles of this world, rather than on Christ. Basic principles is the Greek word stoicheia. Entire doctrinal dissertations have been written on what that word means because it's kind of hard to zero in on. It means a lot of different things, can be used in a lot of different ways. Paul doesn't use it very often, so we don't really know how he tended to use it. It's from the word stoikos, which in the simplest definition of the word, it means a row, like a row of carrots, just a row. And it became to mean something that is in a row, that is step by step. It came to mean an alphabet because an alphabet is letters in a row, and an alphabet is the fundamental form that you learn so that you can learn language. It's elementary, so it's fundamental. And that's what the word means. It's kind of hard to get exactly what he's saying. But when I look at this word, what I think of is so many of our discipleship processes. They're linear, like a row. You say yes to Jesus, okay, and then you do this. And once you've done that, you graduate to this, and then you do this. And then once you've learned that, then you do this, and then you do this, and then you do this. And you look for someone way back there, and maybe you take them along, and you look for someone up there, and you hope they help you, but it's linear. What Paul is saying here is if you've got that step-by-step mindset, that principle mindset, that list of do's and don'ts, don't let that replace Christ. Look how he describes it in verses 16 and 17. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, or a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These were some of the steps that people were taking, thinking it would help them grow. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. A lot of times, these principles are lists of do's or don'ts. Look at verse 20 through 23 of chapter 2. Since you died with Christ to the basic principles of this world, same word, stoicheia. Since you died to stoicheia, why, as though you still belong to stoicheia, do you submit to its rules? We don't know exactly what stoicheia means, but what we do know is it has a bunch of rules attached to it. Here are some of the rules that they were falling in line with. Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch. These are all designed to perish with use because they're based on human commands and teachings. Such regulations indeed have an appearance of wisdom with their self-imposed worship, their false humility, and their harsh treatment of the body. You'll look pretty religious if you follow these rules, but they lack any value in restraining the flesh, sensual indulgence. My dad grew up in a small house church movement in the northern part of England, and they loved Jesus. Please hear me. The church was grounded in Christ. But then they added a bunch of principles and rules on top of that. Now, my dad was not allowed to dance. Not that he wanted to. He was not allowed to go to movies. He was not allowed to play cards. I'll never forget the time my teenage sister encouraged all of us to play a game of cards, and my dad walked into the kitchen, and she was shuffling the deck like someone from Vegas, you know. My dad, I thought he was going to have a heart attack. Where did you learn to do that? Oh, I've poured into this girl, and she's gone down the card-playing route. No sports on Sunday. My dad was a great athlete. All the teams practiced on Sunday. His parents wouldn't let him. He couldn't play on any of the teams. He literally looked through the Bible for the don't play sports on Sunday, and he couldn't find it anywhere. But it was really an important rule for them. He had to dress a certain way when he went to church. The church had to look a certain way. Every night, my dad had to polish all the shoes in the family and line them up in front of the mantelpiece in case Jesus came back while they were sleeping. because they wanted to be ready for him. That was another one of the rules that they put on. And over the years, my dad rebelled against the rules. By God's grace, he never rebelled against Jesus, but he knew there was something that just wasn't right. All this stuff piled on top of Christ. There's nothing new. Satan's been doing this forever. In churches where Christ has been supplanted, the sermons will fit into these three categories: philosophy of religion, religious traditions, or principles for growth. Those are the sermons you'll hear. When they're preaching those things, Jesus isn't mentioned. Paul's purpose in this letter, he describes it for us in chapter 2, verse 2. Turn there, and I'll read it to you. His purpose in this letter was to set forth the absolute supremacy of Christ and the sole sufficiency of Christ as well. Verse 2, my purpose, that was true of all his ministry, but this letter in particular, my purpose is that they may be encouraged in heart and united in love, so they may have the full riches of complete understanding, in order that they may know the mystery of God, namely Christ, in whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Paul heard that the church was distracted. He knew that a distracted church was a dying church. So he wrote this letter to get them focused on the supremacy and sufficiency of Christ again. Let's talk first of all about the absolute supremacy of Christ. Stand with me. You have to stand when I read this. I'm going to read one of the most beautiful passages in Scripture that speaks of the supremacy of Jesus. It's chapter 1, verse 15 of Colossians. Paul just comes right out and says, hey, this is the one you've forgotten. Listen to how amazing he is. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy, he might be first. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. This is the supreme one, Christ himself. Thank you. Go ahead and have a seat. I'm not going to preach that text. I would need months to preach it. The essence of those verses is simply this: Christ is indispensable. He is. Some people are indispensable. I don't know how many of you Mavericks fans remember what happened to the Mavericks this last year when Dirk got hurt. They lost like 8 in a row. Then Dirk came back and they went and won the NBA championship. Dirk is indispensable to the Mavericks. What would have happened if Lucille Ball had walked off the set of the Lucy show? I'm guessing they would have pulled the plug. What would happen to The Office if Steve Carell stopped showing up? Oh, never mind. He did, didn't he? Yeah, that's what happens, right? What would happen to the trapeze artist if the catcher got laid off in budget cuts? Some people are indispensable. What would happen if the crew of your airplane got raptured and you didn't? What happened to Nirvana after Kurt Cobain took his own life? Some people are just indispensable to the thing they're a part of. My friends, what Dirk Nowitzki is to the Mavericks, Jesus Christ is to the church. What that pilot is to you and your plane, Jesus Christ is to the church. What that catcher is to the trapeze artist who is halfway through their second flip and looking for the hands, that's what Jesus is to the church. He is indispensable. When I went out to Pine Cove this summer with my family, I was teaching at family camp out there. And the first night's always a little awkward because we don't know anyone and they don't know me. And then they find out I'm the speaker. And so people come up and we are chatting and meeting each other. And then they invariably say, so what are you teaching on this week? What are you teaching on this week? And so a woman came up to me, and I was waiting for the question. She said, "So, what are you teaching on this week?" I said, "Jesus." She said, "No, seriously." I said, "Jesus." She said, "Oh." Later that week, at their sharing time at the end of the week, she stood up and she said, "You know, I asked Pete what he was speaking on this week, and he said, Jesus. And my thought was, how could that possibly apply to me?" Friends, did you hear this? This is what the church has done to us. The topic is Jesus, and we think, how could that possibly apply to me? She said, "Now I know better." Because you see, when we preach Christ, we don't just preach his supremacy. We could, that would be enough, but he gives us even more to learn, and that is his sufficiency. The fact that he is all we need. In Colossians 3:11, Paul just comes right in and says it. Christ is all. This mindset that says I need religious philosophy or tradition or principles to complete my Christian experience, that mindset in some way is thinking Jesus is not enough for me. He's not quite enough. I need to add something to him to get the full experience of the Christian life. But Paul is clear in Colossians, Christ is all we need. Let me show you what I mean. Look in chapter 1, verse 21. Christ is all we need for cleansing. He's all we need for cleansing. "Once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. But now," he's speaking to believers, "but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight without blemish and free from accusation." Some people will tell you, yes, Jesus is what you need for salvation. Jesus plus baptism. You have to be, if once you get baptized, then you're saved. Jesus plus baptism. No. Some will say, yeah, Christ is important, but it's Christ plus works. No, it's not. Christ plus confession. No. Christ plus church attendance. No. Christ plus tithing. No. Christ plus nothing. Yes. Jesus is enough. The death of Christ has made it possible for a formerly filthy individual to be cleansed so thoroughly that Scripture describes us as holy in his sight, without blemish, free from accusation. Solely on the work of Christ and Christ alone. But that's just page one of War and Peace. That's true. But that's just page one of War and Peace. There is so much more. In chapter 1, verse 25, Christ is all we need for closeness too. Paul says, "I've become its servants, the church's servant, by the commission God gave me to present to you the word of God in its fullness, the mystery that's been kept hidden for ages and generations, but is now disclosed to the saints. To them, God has chosen to make known among the Gentiles the glorious riches of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory." Prepositions are so important. It's not Christ with you. It's not Christ near you. Not even Christ under you. Christ in you. Paul is consistent in all his letters. The moment we trust Christ for salvation, by his Spirit, he comes to indwell us. Christ in you. And my friends, this is the only hope we have for glory. Some of you feel, you know, I just want to get closer to God. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ, let me tell you something. You can't get any closer to God. How can you get any closer than God being in you? Those of you who are here at Bent Tree right now, you are sitting in the worship center. You are in the worship center. I want you to come up with a way that you could get closer to the worship center than you are right now. How could the worship center get closer to you than it is right now? It couldn't. You're in it. Scripture is clear. If you are a believer in Jesus Christ, he lives in you. Friends, you cannot get any closer to him. You say, "Well, Pete, you don't understand. I sinned this week." Well, welcome to the human race. But go on. "Well, I sinned this week, And so God has turned his back on me. Whoa, stop. Where does it say that? Well, what I know, Pete, is that my relationship with God is secure, but my fellowship with him can be broken. Where does it say that? When I sin, if Christ is in me, when I sin, it deeply grieves him. When I sin, it injures me. When I sin, it injures those who love me and those whom I love. Please hear me. Sin sucks, but it does not break my fellowship with him. It does not break my relationship with him. He lives in me. That never changes. My friends, you cannot get any closer to Jesus than you are right now if you're in Christ. Christ is all we need for cleansing. He's all we need for closeness. Verse 28, Christ is all we need for content. Now we're speaking to the leaders in the church, the preachers, the teachers, the small group leaders. Verse 28, we proclaim him, admonishing and teaching everyone with all wisdom, so that we may present everyone perfect, that word means mature, in Christ. How do we help people mature? As leaders, as teachers, as small group leaders, how do we help them mature? Not with systems, not with principles, not with traditions, not with philosophy. We point them to Christ. We proclaim Christ, admonishing and teaching everyone in Christ. To this end, he says, I labor, struggling with all his energy, Christ's energy, which works so powerfully in me. Christ wants to point people to himself through us. A number of years ago, Charles Haddon Spurgeon was the most popular preacher in the world. People all over England would go to hear him preach on Sundays in London. He said a number of things about preaching. I want to share some of them with you. A sermon without Christ in it is like a loaf of bread without any flour in it. No Christ in your sermon, sir? Then go home and never preach again until you have something worth preaching. Leave Christ out? Oh, my brethren, better leave the pulpit out altogether. If a man can preach one sermon without mentioning Christ's name in it, it ought to be his last. Certainly the last that any Christian ought to go and hear him preach. A sermon without Christ as its beginning, middle, and end is a mistake in conception and a crime in execution. However grand the language, it will be merely much ado about nothing if Christ be not there. Yes, it is Christ, Christ, Christ whom we have to preach. And if we leave him out, we leave out the very soul of the gospel. Christless sermons make merriment for hell. Wow. Christless preachers, Christless Sunday school teachers, Christless class leaders, what are all these doing? If you leave Jesus Christ out, you're simply beating the air. I knew one who said I was always on the same old string, and he would not come and hear me anymore. But if I preached a sermon without Christ in it, he would come. Ah, he will never come while this tongue moves. For a sermon without Christ in it, a Christless sermon, is a brook without water, a cloud without rain. A well which mocks the traveler. What a phrase. Someone is traveling, they're thirsty, they're parched, they desperately want water. They see a well, they run over, they look over, it's dry. It's a well that mocks the traveler. People come to hear of Christ and we preach and we don't mention him. It's a well that mocks the people who come to hear of him. A tree twice dead, plucked up by the root. A sky without a sun, a night without a star. It were a realm of death, a place of mourning for angels and laughter for devils. Oh, Christian, we must have Christ. There was a contemporary preacher, to Spurgeon in London in that day. His name was Dr. Joseph Parker. He was a great orator. And two men went to hear him preach one Sunday, and they came away from the church, and they said, and I quote, "My, what eloquence! He know how to choose the right words and say them. His oratory is simply irresistible, end quote. The same two men went to hear Spurgeon the following Sunday. They left the service silently and reverently, and all they said was, "My, what a Christ. What a Christ." My friends, Christ is all we need for content. As we teach, as we lead, as we disciple, we point people to Him because He is the only one that can bring life and bring change and bring transformation. Look at chapter 2, verse 6. I'll go through these quickly. We're running out of time. Christ is all we need for Christian living. So then, just as you receive Christ Jesus as Lord, continue to live in Him, rooted and built up in Him, strengthened in the faith as you were taught, and overflowing with thankfulness. Just as you received Christ Jesus as Lord. How did you receive Him? By faith, by trusting Him. Just as you received Him, by faith, live in Him, by faith. This is the Christian life, friends. Living, trusting Jesus, moment by moment, constant conversation, constantly seeking His wisdom, His discernment, His will. What would you have me do here, Jesus? What would you have me say now, Jesus? How would you have me pray for this person, Jesus? How would you have me vote as I'm going into this booth, Lord Jesus? What does relating to this person in you mean, Jesus? How does loving this person look today, Christ? Am I guessing to the answers to all these prayers? No, I'm spending time in the Word because in the Word, He tells me the answers to these things. And by His Spirit, He reminds me of the answers to these things. And the Christian life is walking intimately, dynamically, the adventure of life in Christ. Christ is all we need for Christian living. In chapter 2, verse 9, Christ is all we need for completion. Christ is all we need for completion. For in Christ, all the fullness of deity lives in bodily form. Christ was fully God. And you, listen to this, friends, listen to this. You have been given fullness in Christ, who is the head over every other power and authority. Some of you say, you know, my wife completes me. No, she doesn't. She complicates you. Some of you women say, my husband completes me. No, he doesn't. He confounds you, and you know it. No human being can complete you. Christ can. Christ does. You have been given fullness. The word fullness means to fill a vessel, to fill it to abundance, to be completely satisfied, to be overflowing. It's like taking your car into the gas station and putting that pump in and filling it all the way up so much that it actually spills out a little bit, and you put the can on there and you put it in and you drive out and then you do a U-turn and you drive right back around and you park your car again and you put your credit card in and you try to put more gas in there. What's going to happen? The guy will come running out saying, what are you doing? It's already full. Yeah, but I want more. You can't have any more. You're full. I want more. Why would you want more? You're full. You're being stupid. You're full. Scripture teaches us if we are in Christ, we have the fullness of Christ now. Now. You don't need any more Jesus. He doesn't come in parcels. He comes whole, full. That's why Peter said in 2 Peter 1:3, His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. He's all we need to be complete. Finally, He's all we need for the church as well. Look at chapter 3, verse 11. Here in the church, there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, or free. Social distinctions are irrelevant in the church. Why? But Christ is all and is in all. The reason social distinctions are irrelevant in the church is because Christ is supreme and He says they are. And He's living in all of us, making us all completely equal in Him. Therefore, since Christ indwells believers, since He's in me and in you and all the believers in our church, since we get to live in Him, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. You have all this available to you in Christ, so clothe yourself in these things. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. How do I do this, Paul? Verse 15. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Since as members of one body, you are called to peace and be thankful. Do we want our church to look like this passage right here? Of course we do. How does that happen? All of us let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. We give ourselves over to him. I'm going to ask the band to come on out. We're going to close worshiping Jesus in just a moment. But before we do, I just want to do a couple so whats on this sermon. I think there's two different kinds of people that can apply this sermon. One is those of us who are simply disciples of Jesus. We're followers of Christ, which is, I know, the vast majority of us here. I think our so what is seen at the very beginning of chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, verse 1, which says, since then, or so what, since then, you've been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Paul says, here you go. Here's your first thing I want you to do with this message. I want you to sit down, and I want you to set your heart, your feeler, and your mind, your thinker on Christ, instead of on earthly things. So here's an idea for you tomorrow morning. Get up early, get out your journal, and just start writing these words. Jesus, here are the earthly things that my mind just can't let go of. And just start writing them. You'll be stunned. You'll be writing for quite a while. And then say, all right, Jesus, these are yours. Now, focus my heart and my mind on you the rest of this day. What does this look like? Just ask him, what does this look like? And step into the adventure of walking in Christ all day long. I think there's a second application for this sermon, and that's for those of us who are leaders in the church. It might be in the children's ministry. It might be in the youth ministry. You might lead a small group there or life group leaders. Certainly our pastors here in the church, our lay leadership here in the church, our elders here at Bent Tree. I think also pastors of churches around the world. How do we apply this text? I think Colossians chapter 3:16 is for us. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach. As we preach, as we teach, as we disciple, let the word of Christ dwell in us richly. As we teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as we sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with gratitudes in our hearts to God, whenever we gather for worship, let it be the word of Christ that dwells in us. Let Christ be the focus. And whatever you do, that's pretty all-encompassing, isn't it, folks? And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. One of the banes of my existence is that every sermon I have ever preached here was recorded and is now available for purchase. Wish I could go back and destroy some of the originals. I've always preached biblically. I've always preached expositionally. I have not always driven the text back to Christ. So if you ever hear one of my sermons where I don't end up with Christ, throw it out. Seriously. Jonathan Edwards heard a guy preach one day, and the preacher saw Jonathan Edwards in the congregation. He was so excited, and so he wanted to know what Jonathan Edwards thought of his sermon. So he said, Mr. Edwards, what did you think of my sermon? He said, it was a very poor sermon. A poor sermon, said the preacher. It took me a long time to study it. My explanation of the text was accurate, the illustrations were appropriate, and the arguments conclusive. Will you tell me why you think it a poor sermon? Because, said Jonathan Edwards, there was no Christ in it. Well, said the preacher, Christ was not in the text. We are not to be preaching Christ always. We must preach what is in the text. Then don't take a text without Christ in it, Edwards replied. But you will find Christ in every text if you examine it. From every text in Scripture, there is a road to the metropolis of the Scriptures that is Christ. And my dear brother, your business is, when you get to a text, to say, now, what is the road to Christ? And then preach a sermon running along that road. I have never yet found a text that had not a plain and direct road to Christ in it. And if ever I should find one that has no such road, I will make a road. I would go over hedge and ditch, but I would get at my master. For a sermon is neither fit for the Lord nor yet for the peasant unless there is a savor of Christ in it. Please stand with me. I want to pray for you, and then we're going to worship Jesus together. Lord, my heart's desire for myself, for my family, for my church family, is that we would walk moment by moment trusting you, Jesus. That we would experience life, the life of Christ, moment by moment, just like Paul teaches us in this great letter. Lord, I also, I long to hear Christ preached. Do a work in the church, Lord God, I pray. Bring revival to the church as we focus on Jesus. Let us recognize that we are but Christ with flesh on, the body of Christ on earth. Don't ever let us forget it. Lord Jesus, as we sing these words, we worship your holy name.